You know, we have a long tradition at the MIT Enterprise Forum, about 36 years here on the Central Coast. The organization out of Cambridge, obviously, is 40 years old this year. And so we're celebrating that, and it doesn't happen without the help of all of our sponsors. So I really want to thank all of the sponsors who support MIT Enterprise Forum over the years, and in addition to every year we find, you know, one or two new companies, organizations, or individuals who step up. And so I would encourage you to think about that and join us as we build our community here. And if you want to learn more about us, we're on the internet, mitcentralcoast.org, and on all of the social media platforms with the initials MIT EFCC for MIT Enterprise Forum Central Coast. So that's Facebook, LinkedIn, Instagram, Twitter, probably something I'm forgetting. So please do look for us there. Before I have Doug Lynch come up and kick us off for our energy event, I did want to remind folks that next event is in the third Wednesday in June. We'll be looking at education technology, and we have some really fantastic speakers, both who are building innovative companies in the education technology space, and investor and an advisor who's built two very notable companies, Kinder Music and Hooked on Phonics. And is now helping companies scale and change the education environment across the U.S. So I hope you'll come out and see that one. So that's it for me. I'm going to bring up Doug Lynch to introduce our panel.
Thanks, everybody, for coming. Tonight I'm Doug Lynch. I'm the oil guy on the panel. And I've got a background of about 35 years in upstream oil and gas. Mostly on the organizational effectiveness side, spent a lot of times offshore on platforms and deep water horizon and those sorts of things. We're going to be joined tonight by three other speakers. First will be Craig Christensen of Turbine Technology Partners. We'll be talking about wind and how it's blowing in the wind. And then we'll be followed that by Corey Hovind of Next Energy Technology, which, if you had a chance to see their display over here, windows that generate electricity. And finally, wrapping that up, will be Lawrence Scarpa of Brooks and Scarpa, who will be talking about sort of the microgrid and how you combine all that into architecture. So when we started with Energy 3.0, there are three things, obviously, with that. First, Energy 1.0 is really hydrocarbon-based, locally generated, and locally expensed energy systems. And when we talk about Energy 2.0, primarily hydrocarbon-based, regionally generated, and regionally distributed and locally expensed. So you're making your electricity elsewhere and bringing it in and using it in your homes. And 3.0, where we'll spend a lot of our time tonight, is really alternative energy-based, regionally generated, regionally distributed, and locally generated and locally expensed energy systems. And I hope that makes sense, because we're going to jump right into it. Are you going to be my... So I thought this was an appropriate cartoon for this evening. Energy can only lead to trouble. But when we get into energy point one, which is the next slide, as I say, this is really carbon-based, and it really goes back to the next slide. 700,000 years ago, BC, this is really when our first carbon-based energy really happened, when man got control of fire. Oh. And then 2000 BC was when the Chinese really started using coal. So it's the right button, is that right? Yeah. And then even back in 1000 AD, this is the Persians with windmills. I don't think this is an actual photograph. I think it's a reproduction. But they were generating wind energy back 1000 AD. And then this is up here interesting. This is cow dung, animal dung, that was used, you know, probably started in 2000 BC. And it's still being used today. out there as an energy source in a lot of third world countries. And if you could collect all of the cow manure in the world, it could, and harness it, I mean, which obviously you can't collect it all, but it could supply 10% of the world's energy. So there's a lot of this sort of carbon-based cow dung out there that we can take advantage of if you wanted. And then in the 1700s, things started happening. Anyone know who these three guys are? How about the first guy on the left? Benjamin Franklin. Show me the Benjamins, right? So, inventor, didn't really invent electricity, but, you know, he sort of did the first lightning rod and, you know, about his key on the kite pole thing, or the kite. The middle guy is Alessandro Volta, who an Italian physicist who really was credited with developing the electric battery. And then the third guy, Scotsman, looks a little bit like George Washington, but it's actually James Watt. He invented the steam engine, which really pushed the technology revolution and moved us out into the industrial age with locomotives and steam engines and factories and things. So, and that brings us, obviously we've had this technology revolution with the steam engine and electricity and things. This brings us into energy 2.0. This is the largest dam in the United States, Grand Coulee Dam in Washington. And right now there are about 850 different electrical power plants in the United States. And on average, they're 64 years old. So most of them were built just after World War II. And the 50 oldest generating plants in the United States are all hydroelectric. And they've all been in service since 1908. So that's over 110 years we've been relying on hydroelectric power to generate the majority of our power out there. This is a Schurer coal-fired plant in Georgia. It's the largest coal-fired plant in the United States. 3,500 kilowatts it produces. And the problem with coal, unfortunately, is it's been shown that a lot of research that 91% of all coal-fired power plants are contaminating the water with some sort of toxic chemicals and contaminants. Chemicals, just leave right there. Huge amounts of energy, but also very pollutant, obviously. This is the largest coal-fired plant in the United States, in Florida. One of the things you find with these big plants also, not only do they generate a lot of power, but they're also, they take up a lot of space, right? So there's a lot of room for you can see the cooling waters and the towers and all those sorts of things. So it's not only a lot of energy they're creating, but it's also a lot of space that they end up taking up. Diablo Canyon is not the biggest nuclear power plant in the U.S., but it's the one closest to us, and it's in the process of being shut down. The largest one is actually in Arizona, and it's about 3,000 kilowatts and powers 4 million people from one nuclear power plant. And so I think in 2025 is when they're planning to shut Diablo Canyon down. And right now there are 60 nuclear plants in the United States, and I'm sure you've all heard of the negative side, Three Mile Island, Chernobyl, Fukushima. And has anybody actually seen watching the HBO Chernobyl thing? That's pretty scary, isn't it? But there's really been very few people have died from nuclear energy. I think in Chernobyl, there were only in the hundreds. Nobody in Fukushima, although 16,000 people died from the tidal wave. And there was several deaths with Three Mile Island. If anybody, as I was researching this is Michael Schellenberger. He was the 2008 Time Magazine Hero of the Environment, and he's on a TED Talks, TEDx Danubia, if anybody wants to look it up, where he's really become a proponent for nuclear energy, and really, you know, how safe and the amount of energy that it can create. See this little Rubik's Cube down here? a Rubik's cube of uranium can generate enough power for a person for their whole lifetime. So there's a lot of power, obviously, in nuclear, and it has gotten a bad name because of the problems, but it's a great, it does have huge potential for, in essence, clean energy. Two things with this sign. Anyone figure out what those two things are? Yeah, right now there's probably be a four in front of it. So the price, and also when was the last time you ever saw actually unleaded gas for sale? Now it's just gas, right? This was probably back in the mid-70s when they had leaded and unleaded gas, and the EPA came in to remove it. Right in here, this spot right here, this is our oil production. In about 2018, we're going to be oil free, or at least from imports. Anyone figure out what happened down there, where the lightning bolt is? That was when technology helped us mine shale oil. And the United States has, the shale oil reserves in the United States are 25 times the size of Saudi Arabia's reserves. So there's a lot of shale oil out there. Fracking obviously has got a bad name. So you can see here we're going to be, you know, sometime this year we'll be net importing of energy. And Santa Barbara has a long history of oil and gas. This was Semiland in around the 1900s. They realized that not only where they can get in with piers, you can build platforms offshore. Santa Barbara has 20 platforms out there, 15 of them in state waters, 5 of them in Santa Barbara and Ventura County waters. 50 years ago, last month, Union Platform A had the big blowout. Something over 200,000 barrels of oil spilled onto the ocean, and here are people out here cleaning them out. And this oil spill is really the activator for Earth Day. And out of Earth Day came the EPA, came the Clean Water Act, the Clean Air Act, Environmental Protection Agency. So that oil spill in Santa Barbara and all those environmentalists that helped clean up and activate after it, GOO, Get Oil Out, came a couple years before Greenpeace. So here's where we are right now. Oil, natural gas, coal, and you can see up here at the top, wind and energy. And this is the only one that really is expanding out there, right? But part of the problem is this. Four of the top 10 largest companies in the world are oil and gas companies. Sinopec and China National, Royal Dutch, and ExxonMobil. So we're in trouble, but all is not lost, because every 2.5 minutes, a new solar energy system is installed in the U.S. Tokelau was the first place in the world where 100% of electrical power was generated through solar panels. This is a small island that's a territory of New Zealand. Also concern for environmental and climate change, because the highest point is 5 meters above sea level. So the sea level starts rising, they're in trouble. Wind produced 68% of Scotland's electricity consumption in 2018. It's contributing a large portion to the energy in the UK. Kenya is going big in geothermal. They've cut their imports by 50% by using geothermal, and they're installing the largest wind farm in Africa sometime this year. It should be up and running. Scandinavian countries are leading the charge. Sweden become the first nation to go oil-free. Costa Rica goes 300 days using only renewable energy in 2018. And part of the problem with this is that when they talk about these oil or these energy days, they're not talking about transportation. They're only talking about electricity used in homes. So 70% of all the oil in the U.S. is consumed for transportation. And how many of you drove here today? You know, how many of you drove in your electric car? I saw one or two Teslas out there. Very good. So Tesla's leading the way. You probably recognize this. They're out there. BMW's got their this little thing, the i3. The Nissan Leaf, an electric car. The Bolt, Chevy Bolt. And this is the Kia. I think this is the Kia one. Ford. This is a Ford Focus. And this is the Kia Soul, which are basically electric versions of their own cars. And this is the one I'm waiting for. Volkswagen's bringing the bus back as an electric version. It's going to be sold in the United. They're hoping by 2022 to have it on the market. So I used to have an old 67 bus that was almost as cool as that. And Tesla is bringing in the semis. This semi battery can charge in 2 hours and 500 miles of transportation or one fill. So all is not lost. We're still very dependent on oil and gas, and there's a lot happening out there. And that leads us into Energy 3.0. And part of that becomes Craig Christensen will talk to us about this alternate energy and the use of wind and how we're going to harness that as an electrical source. So thank you very much.
Hi, my name's Craig Christensen. I want to start with a little personal story. About 25 years ago, I was hiking up in the mountains here. I had come to Santa Barbara to get my engineering degree, had been working 10 or 12 years, not really doing what I wanted to do. Had an epiphany during the hike, looking out over the channel, beautiful day. Came home and told my wife, who was pregnant with our third child, I said, I have this great idea. I'm going to quit my job, which I've, you know, mastered over the last dozen years. I'm going to follow my heart into wind energy, which is a passion of mine, into an industry that doesn't exist yet. We probably have to sell our house, move from Santa Barbara, and I look over at her, and this is a hint to you guys, don't ever tell your pregnant wife this type of news. So I'm here a little bit to tell you about my personal story, but more than that, it's about what I was part of in the development of an industry, a non-existent industry, and what has now become a real industry. It's right now for a utility looking to install new power generation. Their choices are very clear. They can either put in wind, combined cycle natural gas, or solar. Those are the best three choices. But it wasn't always like that. So we're going to hear a little bit about my story, but it's really more important as we look at going from Energy 2.0 to Energy 3.0, the new technologies that will have to come about, what was the path that the wind energy took, what kind of obstacles did we overcome, and also what was the catalyst, what really were the tipping points, and I'm going to talk about that, what really helped wind get to where it is today. First of all, we have to really recognize something about energy. A lot of us take it for granted. We just saw that there are several different types of energy. We get it from different sources. In the beginning, we burned wood. We cut down trees. And you can see in this chart from 1850, we started a decline of burning wood. And the reason was very clear. We chopped down all the trees. And we found something more important, something easier to mine, something that had a higher BTU content, much more energy dense. We could transport it easier. Then we found oil. Saw a great picture here of Summerlin, the beach in Summerlin. I'm so glad all those derricks are gone because I like going to that beach. But the reality is that that was a very important part of the oil history for this area. Along with oil came gas. And so we started producing gas. Gas burned cleaner. Gas was easier to transport. Both oil and gas can go in pipelines where coal can't, so there's advantages to each. But the important thing here is that as we're looking and innovating, we're trying to find better ways of energy, better ways to tap into our energy resources. Then the Depression happened, and in the 30s, we saw a picture of Grand Coulee of FDR with the New Deal created the CCC, and we put men to work. We built dams. We dammed all kinds of rivers. We dammed up all the rivers. In fact, you see hydro kind of peaked. And the reason is we ran out of rivers. We ran out of rivers to dam. And so with everything, every time we find a new source of energy, we seem to find limitations, whether it be an environmental consequence, whether it be a cost consequence, or in this case, lack of resource. Then, we figured out how to split the atom. Fission was invented. We built our first nuclear power plants. But then very quickly, right after that, we had the accident at Three Mile Island. We then had, in 86, Chernobyl. We then had, just a few years ago, the Fukuyama accident. So it has its limitations, too. And then ultimately, we know there is another source here. This one might be the most challenging one. And this is the one that we're going to talk about tonight, is the future with wind and photovoltaics and other renewables. We've been trying to tap into wind resources for a long time. This is a picture of a Dutch windmill. These wooden windmills, there's still some that exist. They've brought them back. They've preserved them. You can actually go inside and see the gears are made out of wood. The shafts are made out of wood. They're quite innovative. They're quite nice to look at, and they're functional. They grind grain. We've been using wind also with clipper ships to basically move people and cargo around the oceans for hundreds of years. We've also are entertained by wind. We entertain ourselves with wind. We use wind for recreation. And it's something that we do this because it's not utilitarian, because we enjoy it. And this has actually helped our industry. We learn from this type of activity. We learn how to make better machines because of this. So what happens? How did we get from what's on the left here, which is a conventional water pumping windmill that was installed by the thousands in the American Midwest, to this modern high-tech machine that generates electricity? Was it an evolution of technology, or really is it more a revolution? What I'm here to talk about tonight is really how it takes passion, it took dedication, it took innovation, it took some very dedicated people to go from what you see on the left to the right, and it took a lot of time to do that. One of the early wind energy pioneers lives here in Santa Barbara. His name is Jim Dielson. He was living in San Ynez Valley and decided to get into wind. So if he's going to build a company to be in wind, he thought, I got to go where the wind is. So he moved his small company to Tatchby. And he started out in the 80s, and they initially bought turbines from a company in San Diego. That's shown here on the right, the guy on the top, that's a Stormmaster turbine. Turned out they're very unreliable, they broke, they couldn't handle the wind. So Jim's solution was, let's buy technology from Denmark. And so the turbines on the left were the first imported machines from Denmark. They're Vestas machines. This company was a company that just started a few years earlier. They'd made tractors, and so their technology was trusty like a tractor, and it worked in the Tatchby Pass. And so Jim, after about 10 years, he developed a very good operations company. They bought technology from Europe, they brought it to the US, installed it, and they installed 2,500 of these machines throughout California, in the Palm Springs area, in the Tatchby area, also in the Altamont Pass. And so at one point, about a dozen years later, they decided as a company, we need to vertically integrate this. We need to design these machines here. We need to manufacture these machines in the US. So he set out to hire some engineers. I was engineer number 4 that came in the door. We had a team of about a dozen engineers and technicians, very talented group. We worked for about a year and a half, 2 years, and this was our first machine. It's called the Zon Z40, a 500 kilowatt machine. It was installed first in West Texas, and then also we installed some in Vermont. This machine, we made about 100 of these machines. Roughly 30 of them went to China. We had 27 that went to Greece, 10 that went to Ireland, and the rest of them here were installed in the US. This was our first machine out of the box. It was designed in America, it was made in America, and we were very proud of it. A lot of passion went into this. We had a very, very passionate group of people working on this. But we couldn't stay still because this machine wasn't really that cost competitive. We're still trying to compete not against other wind turbine manufacturers, but against natural gas. Natural gas at the time was the best choice for a new power plant. So we worked harder. We came up with the next machine. This is a 750 kilowatt machine called the Zon Z50. This was produced in 97 and 99, a 3-year period. This machine was bigger. It could power about 300 homes versus the previous machine was only about 150 homes. And with this machine, we were able to then build the largest wind power plant in the US. It was, at that time, it's a plant in Lake Benton, Minnesota, 100 megawatt plant. That plant could make enough power to power a city the size of Santa Barbara. So that was, at the time, the biggest wind power plant in the world. It was made right in Tatchby. Those machines were made in Tatchby. At this point, we needed more money. We needed more capital to grow the business. So we found a little company in Houston called Enron. You might have heard of them. So they invested in our company. We became Enron Wind. We had all the money we needed to build a new manufacturing plant in Tatchby. We built the largest power plants in the world at the time, all over the U.S. We sent these machines to several different places. We installed them in Spain. We actually built a manufacturing plant in Spain. We acquired a company in Germany, so we expanded into Germany, which is a very important market at the time. So at this time, we had, in 1999, we had a division in Tatchby, we had a division in Germany, and a division in Spain. And so we were growing. Unfortunately, our parent company, Enron, they went bankrupt. So along came GE. GE bought us out of the bankrupt ashes, let's call it, of Enron. We were the shiny nugget in the bankrupt ashes. We were highly profitable at that time. We were highest revenue year, highest profitability year, and in the collapse of Enron, GE came and said, we want that wind company, and we became GE Wind. By this time, we had a global team. We had engineers in Germany and Spain and California, and we innovated on this machine. It's the largest machine that we come up with at that time, 1.5 megawatts or 1,500 kilowatts. This machine over the next 5, 6, 7 years became the most produced wind turbine in the world. In fact, today, this is one of the most reliable and most produced, most installed wind turbines as a result of that. Great things started to happen. We got a lot of recognition. We started getting press on magazine covers. It was the poster child. These are probably magazines you don't read, but we were all over those magazines. And we even had Huell Hauser, California Gold, come to Tatchby. We got him to climb up to the top of our turbine, and he actually got very nervous. It's a funny, hilarious episode if you ever watch that show. He's a little corny, but he had a good time. We had a great show, and it's something you can watch. We also had Modern Marvels come to Tatchby. They want to know what kind of oil we put in our turbines. And that was my first opportunity to be on TV. Come home, tell my wife and kids, we make popcorn. All the 2 hours that they had filmed me during the day turned into like a minute and a half of me being interviewed. So that's when I learned that my career in Hollywood would be very short. So what happened? At this point, we're getting a lot of press. There's something, though, that we weren't really getting all the momentum we needed. But there's a book that's written by Malcolm Gladwell, which you've probably read. If you haven't, I recommend you do. And it identifies what really are the catalysts to really make things tip. And I'd like to come up with what I would call an explanation of what really happened with the industry and what really tipped us. And so in this case, what we'd been working on for a couple years was the cost of energy reduction. As we're making the machines larger and larger, we're driving down the cost of wind-generated electricity that's coming out of those machines. And at some point, we cross over that magical barrier, which is what the utilities have as their other option, combined cycle natural gas. Once we hit that tipping point in terms of price, that's when it happens, and that's what happened to us. Our machines were getting so big now, it created challenges for us. If you look here on the design side, on the blades, lower left, we had to come up with new innovative ways to design the blades. We had to come up with innovative ways to transport the blades. These right here, in fact, this is a special truck design just for taking blades. It extends with the length of the blade. This is a nice opportunity for anyone who's looking for a job. This is now, we actually have crews right now that are working out in North Dakota and doing this today. And so if you want a new job, want an exciting job, these are rock climbers that are basically found a way to find their skills and get paid very well for applying their skills. So what happened was the first tipping point was when we actually crossed over. We crossed over as the cost came down, this curve here. At some point here, right around 7 cents a kilowatt hour, we had this first tipping point. I'd like to believe it was when I first joined the industry, was right here in 94. I thought maybe I was a tipping point, but that would be maybe not true. But actually, I feel like I was there when it happened, so maybe it's part of it. But the tipping point was really when the cost of energy actually came down, and it became then for a utility, this is a real option. Because for utilities, it's not, they don't really care if it's green and clean. I'm being a little bit facetious here, but they really want to have cost-effective electricity generation. If it's green and clean, that's fine. But what they're really caring about is the cost. So what I would like you to look at here, there is another inflection here in this curve. This is installed capacity. You can see here at one point it really starts to accelerate straight up. So what is, there must be another tipping point. So if you look at what happened there, here's another list of, this is the largest companies. This is, happens to be the global Fortune 500 list, 2007. And yes, there are some of the big oil companies on it. You see, number 3 is Shell, number 4 is BP, but also you see number 11 is General Electric, and number 22 is Siemens. So what do they have in common? Well, guess what? They all joined wind right between the years of 2001 and 2006. So GE and Siemens joined on the supply side. They started looking at how can we join making this equipment and making money off this equipment. And Shell and BP joined on the demand side. They started buying wind power plants. One of our first wind power plants with the 750 kilowatt machine, was the output was bought by Shell, a new group called Shell Renewables. So they were thinking outside of their box, oil and gas, and yes, renewables. BP the same way. 2005, they started buying wind power plants, wind power plant outputs. And so what happens here is with these big companies now, the whole game changes. Now there's exposure. First thing, I come home and we watch the Super Bowl in January 2003, and I'm amazed to see this.
Imagine what a pleasant surprise it must have been when man first harnessed the power of wind. At GE, we still believe in wind as a pure, natural source of power. GE Wind Energy. For a cleaner, more fuel-efficient world. GE. Imagination at work.
And then 2 years later, another Super Bowl ad comes out.
Listen to the wind of my soul. Where I'll end up, well, I think only God really knows. I've sat upon the setting sun, but never, 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 never. I never wanted water once.
Capturing the wind and putting it to good use. Wind energy from GE. Some of the cleanest renewable energy on Earth.
So now with these big companies, the influence that they bring, the name recognition, things change for us and change for the industry. And you can see the growth rate starts to accelerate through 2006, 2007, 2008, and 2009. Well, here we are now years later, another 10 years later, but it's still happening. So I propose there's still another force that's tipping us into another huge growth period. And this is the corporate reaction now of what's happening the last 2 years. Very large companies, primarily the tech companies started it, Google, Apple, Microsoft, Amazon, Facebook. They're buying power purchase agreements. They're buying renewable energy. They have signed up to commit to renewable energy future. They did this for business reasons, because if you buy power that's coming from a renewable energy power plant, you have fixed costs for the next 20 years. It makes good business sense. You don't rely on the variable cost of, say, a gas-fired power plant. There's a new organization called RE100. They've signed up over 100 companies now that have committed around the world to have 100% of their energy come from renewables. And so this is happening right now. This is really the third tipping point. And so this shows us that it's not just about utilities buying power now, it's about companies doing the right thing. And this is a group of companies, big and small. Some you recognize, some you don't. There's one more video I have here from Mars, the maker of M&Ms. Thank you very much.
extremely technically sophisticated process to put these on. It does something very similar to what we do. So we take UV and IR and convert to electricity. Low E takes UV and IR and reflects them back, makes it somebody else's problem, but that's the technology. It was invented, kind of started in the 1980s, and now it goes into pretty much every window across the world. It's regulated to these, so return on investment is, that's not the driving force. And it goes on to the north side of the building, it goes on to the south side, it goes on every side because that's what's required basically by law around the world. And so this does that. This already does what those windows do, but this now is generating a significant amount of energy for the building and to help them meet the net zero energy building standards. And so where we partner is at the fabricator level. The glass structure is kind of complicated. Fabricator is somebody who takes two pieces of glass, cuts them, and makes insulated glass units. So again, they're the people who make a very critical component that would be in solar technology. They encapsulate the device. And that's where we have to partner, is at the fabricator level. And we've already done that. We've partnered with one of the most prestigious fabricators in the world. They finished our last round of funding. They've invested pretty significantly into our company in terms of NRE, and they've committed to building production lines. So how our business model works is we are partnering with fabricators kind of around the world and licensing the technology and selling them ink, and now they will build production lines. We're going with this model for a whole number of reasons. One, it allows us to disrupt the market as little as possible. These people have all the market connections, and they have brand names. And the one we partnered with so far is probably the most prestigious brand name in the world. So in a market that isn't used to necessarily taking large risks, that's particularly helpful for us. It also allows us to scale. Windows are different than normal solar. China took over solar because they're doing economies of scale. That's not how windows are sold in the world. They're sold regionally. Most of the big companies exist regionally, and that is not going to change. It's just through the way they have to be delivered to buildings. And so we can kind of partner with fabricators all around the world, and not they do the capital, they do the production costs, and that allows us to scale really quickly. We're super excited about that. And as I mentioned, we have one big one. We're kind of replicating that around the world. Obviously, as I mentioned, it is an enormous market. This is just one data point. There's a lot of them. This comes from Mavic Research, who's predicted that the next gen window, the zero energy related product and service market for glazing would be $370 billion by 2035. And this is kind of ours as a company. Our projections. It's a safe, extremely conservative projection. You see, in 2027. Taking a tiny chunk of Asia, small chunk of the U.S., and these again might be very conservative. You look how low E took over the world. It went from nothing in the 1980s to pretty much ubiquitous around the world now. But even with these conservative estimates, as a company like us, it's quite promising. We're out there talking to people. It's a very different thing than technology people like myself are used to doing in photovoltaics, where they're just worried about making a product that's a photovoltaic generating energy. We're making something beautiful. And there's a whole artistic component to this. We're working with architects and building owners, and we already have a great group of them behind us. As an example, here is a quote from Andy Cohen. He's the co-CEO of Gensler, which is the largest architecture firm in the world. Famous on the skylines of Dubai, Shanghai. He is on our board of directors, and extremely helpful in navigating a product that looks like a normal window and the consumers are going to want. And so that, I'd just like to say thank you very much. Really appreciate your guys' attention. Again, appreciate the opportunity.
That was in 2000, and this was the first LEED certified residential project in the world, and we thought we were, as my mother would describe, just doing Jewish common sense. You know, anyone out there not like fresh air, cross ventilation? Raise your hand if you don't like natural light, or clean, non-toxic indoor environment. That's basically what we did. But this building also generated 90% of its own power. But part of what we did, and while I think energy generation is important, you also have to reduce the demand. And so this building was designed to actually reduce the energy demand by 50%. So like you see here, these solar panels actually provide shading to the building, which reduces heat load to it. And people, you know, would ask, hey, it's got vertical solar panels, aren't those less efficient? Well, in theory, yes, but in practice, they don't accumulate dirt like horizontal panels do. So when nobody cleans their roof panels, the production is about the same. But again, you know, this is a building that wears its kind of energy on its sleeve, but it doesn't always have to be that way. But we did simple things like the right orientation. You can see here these things induce airflow through the building. So you open the windows, and to this day, these tenants say, you know, they complain that sometimes they're too cold with no air conditioning. And, you know, I would also argue that a building that is an energy hog that everyone loves is more sustainable than a zero energy building that nobody likes. So you have to do things that people like. You can see here the south, it's all shaded by this brise soleil. The north has windows right on the face. And so we did things that make sense. It's hard to see this, but that's called blown-in cellulose insulation. Any of you out there, even in your own home, this is the best bang for buck you can do. Insulation is like a balloon with a pinhole. So when you put those bats in your building, all those gaps, that's where you lose energy. This blows in its paper. It covers every nook and cranny. So it's super efficient, pays back in like 1 year's time. We did other things with this, like you see over here on your left-hand side, that's a microturbine. So when you get energy to your home from a plant, you get it at about 30% efficient. We have a microturbine, which we produce our power right on site. So we get it, we use the heat that's generated, the waste byproduct, to heat hot water for the building. So this is 95% efficient power to the building. You know, this changed everything for our society. In 1948, there were less than 75,000 of these things in the world. And you know where we are today with this. Before air conditioning, this is how we built buildings. Like if you look at the floor plan, you can see a building that had a wide central space. Here's a hallway with windows in it, operable windows. Look at how many lights are in that space. Almost none, but it's well lit. After air conditioning, this is how we built buildings. This is one of the most famous architectural buildings by Mies van der Rohe. But look at the lights in the lobby, no natural light. We got stupid all of a sudden. Once we got air conditioning, we said, we don't actually need to design the building. We just do whatever we want and put air conditioning in it, put light in it. And so basically we became consumers in the building industry. So you can see the difference between the plans. They're completely different in how you actually make it. Look at the interiors, how different they are. So, you know, we always look at models when we design things of like that work. This is a school in New Orleans done in the 1950s. No air conditioning in New Orleans. But you look, this is their plan. It's almost exactly like the Monadnock building I showed you, with the wide central space, single-loaded rooms, lots of natural light, cross ventilation. There you go, there's the plan, almost identical. And you get this space, which is quite beautiful. But you know, then along comes air conditioning, and some genius at their school board says, you know what, we can make that building a lot better if we put air conditioning in it. And so that's what it looks like now. They go, this is hot in here now. We can't cool it off enough. What wasn't designed that way? And so, you know, buildings that perform are designed. You can't just throw energy systems on them. They are like a complete package. So there are other building types like that. All of these are fantastic models, but they have a lot of the same characteristics in their design. And so all of these are super efficient. They reduce their load of energy in before the first thing is added to them. These are already efficient buildings. And so we, when we design buildings, we basically take that approach. Like this school takes a lot of those same principles that I showed you of cross ventilation, natural light. We have something that induces airflow through the building. It's facing into the prevailing breezes. And so it's got 600 solar panels built into the facade. And this building, again, like the one I showed you, is an expression of the solar panels, but it generates 80% of its own power. And it does so by reducing the load, but also providing the power. And you get these classrooms that have, you know, beautiful light in them. And the kids love it. It shades its own exterior space, so no need for extra canopies. This is a house, too, recently finished, net zero house. So again, common sense, high roof has solar, low roof is green, all the water's collected, you generate the power, and here's the plan. Again, you just for comparison, you can see it's not something we're inventing, it's already there. Kind of sense. And just to give you an idea of what it looks like, these single room deep, you can open all the doors, the air blows right through it, green roofs, and here you see the green roof and the bedrooms all open out, small but well lit, and it's got a 12 kW solar system on it. It uses no energy. This house, zero energy. So I took this picture 2.5 years after it was finished. This was their first trash pickup. So in LA, we didn't know this, but we figured out that your trash pickup is tied to your utility bill. So they never had a utility bill, so they couldn't get trash service. So they used their neighbor's cans for 2.5 years, and they were so proud, they called me up and said, you got to come over, we're getting our first trash pickup. And we do this with all of our projects. They're all LEED, Platinum. They all employ the same principles no matter what they are. 57 unit affordable housing in Palm Springs with the deep overhangs, you provide shade. It's a very passive. This is a housing project in Hollywood. We came up with this idea of a shutter, right? Because it's got beautiful views downtown and to Hollywood, but it's on a busy street, so the shutter acts not just as a performative measure, but also you can get privacy, you can, you know, if you want less light, more light. So in a way, the building kind of redesigns itself every day, but it's also, again, a performative part of the building. And it has the solar panels, it has all the characteristics of the other projects that I showed you. Same thing for this one is 52 units for homeless vets in MacArthur Park, LEED Platinum building, but the same basic principles apply. Downtown Santa Monica, this is 46 units for mentally disabled people, another LEED Platinum building, where we use this, you know, screen to not only be part of the aesthetic, but also be part of the performative nature of the 2005, and this is a zero energy building as well. It has 90 solar panels on it, lots of natural light, cross ventilation. We rarely turn the lights on to this day, but just to give you an idea, when we put these panels on, each one of those panels, think of it as a 60 watt light bulb. Okay, today, that same size panel is a 300 watt light bulb. So the inverters, the technology has completely changed. So it's continuing to change pretty dramatically. The technology and the rules regarding energy are changing very dramatically. Everyone knows him, right? We really know him as the Godator. He didn't get as much credit as I think he deserves for some of the things he did on our energy side. So in 2006, he got AB 32 passed, which had a dramatic impact on us in California. So, and that was to reduce our greenhouse gases by 25% by 2020. Okay, we already met that goal. We met it early, so we basically have now doubled that by 2030. So we've gone basically when everyone was complaining that this is going to kill our economy, we went from the 8th to 9th largest economy in the world, California, to the 5th largest economy today. So while we were doing that, we had some of our geniuses from other industries said, I have an idea in 2008. We can save you a lot of money by giving you a deal on gas. And they made these gas calculators and how much money you could save if you buy a Chevy Suburban, how much gas money. That was their strategy for winning. Well, we know what happened there, right? That really didn't work, but we have a lot going for us in California. So we've made revisions to our code every 2 years in California. So our buildings are being required to be more and more efficient. So now, if any architects are in the room and don't know that any buildings permitted, residential buildings permitted in 2020 and beyond, must be net zero. So all the people in the energy sector, there's going to be a great opportunity because you still need open space and they're going on the roofs and they're running out of space for solar panels. So windows are going to be a great place for them. And then, you know, like I said, what's happened is we've now become the 5th largest economy in the world by doing all of these sustainable and energy measures. So it's kind of amazing what we've been doing, and we seem to keep like doubling down, which is really a good thing. But the real point I want to make is that you can't just do it by producing better and more energy. You have to also be mindful of reducing your reliance on such. I want to close with this, which is a little bit off the track, but it's salient to California. You know, water is going to be our next big issue, and it's particularly going to be an issue here in California. So we use tremendous amounts of water in North America. So on average, an average North American spends about 150 hours a year gardening or on yard work, and we spend less than 30 hours a year on sex. So something's wrong there. 60% of our drinking water goes to watering grass. And then of the five most common grasses that are used in North America, none of them are native to North America. And so in the U.S., we spend more on grass care and lawn care than the entire world spends on foreign aid. So, and that's not even mentioning that there's 60 million kilotons of pesticides that we use on that. So I'm going to kind of leave you with that. Thank you.
Industry,
opposite. Like if you look at outlawing two-stroke engines, if you look at CAFE standards for automobiles, all of that starts from California. So we have in place the infrastructure for innovation in kind of the building industry. It's just, it's waiting there to be like gobbled up. There's no question about it.
Great. Well, are there any questions we have from the audience for any of our presenters?
Thanks for the presentation. Question for Corey and Craig. I mean, Craig finally mentioned the S word, that being storage. And obviously solar and to some extent wind are discontinuous energy sources. You know, the sun typically sets every night. And I think, is it getting, are these technologies getting ahead of storage? What about compression storage and that? So that's one question, is where is storage going to fit into this? The other one is about the energy density of solar. I'm talking about buildings that are self-sustaining with respect to being able to generate their own local power based on their footprint. But the energy density of solar is such that it's never going to work for a car body shop and arc welder, right? I mean, and to extrapolate that out to manufacturing facilities, there's a lot more energy going to be required per building per square foot than the sun even provides for that type of footprint. So if you could discuss those, the storage, and also the how do you deal with the energy density with respect to local power?
Absolutely. In terms of the storage, one of the great things that we're really excited about our technology is we're generating energy where it needs it, when it needs it. So the buildings are huge consumers of energy, as opposed to a utility scale solar installation or residential. Both of those really have to enter the grid, which actually brings in a whole lot of issues. At the building, it's an interesting room. I mean, are we energy generation? Are we energy efficiency? It's kind of a different, weird way to look at it, because we're making that building use the grid less and saving it energy. And right now, you know, you can get away with that with the grid. The peak is quickly changing because solar is becoming. So peak energy is when energy is the most expensive because it's most demanded. And that is when solar normally generates the most energy. So they correlate beautifully. But a lot of solar is coming on the market very quick, which is an amazing thing. But it is already, you're seeing that shift to peak when the most expensive energy is. And so yeah, at some point, batteries are going to have to be introduced into the equation. And luckily, there's, you know, that's starting to get a great payback as well. Some new technologies, just the mass production of that. So it looks like the timing could be perfect.
Well, it's coming, because what's also happening now is, court, you were allowed a net meter, but only a 10 kW system. So that house I showed has a 14 kW system. So we actually fought the state to increase that to 100 kW. And we basically, there was a political fight because the head of the Public Utilities Commission was the former head of Edison. You know, so you get the fox guarding the hen house. And, you know, there's a lot of money in energy. So, you know, there's a lot of conflict. And so what's now happening is the legislation regarding net metering is also changing. So we're not going to allow to net meter the way we've currently been able to do it. So they're going to change it to time of use. So if you actually produce more power during the day today, the meter spins backwards. And when you go home, you get that as a credit when the sun's not out and it moves forward. So the utility company is the battery. Okay, now they're going to have, when the time of use comes in, they're basically going to say, if you backfeed our system and you're not using the energy, we're actually going to take it, but we're going to charge you for it. And so batteries are going to have to be there because it's the inverters now are being made that are smart, so they can regulate and transfer the power to batteries, but the battery technology is not there yet, and we need that.
Yeah. Well, I'd like to comment first on the residential piece, and I'll talk more about the utility scale piece. I went and got a bid for the PV installation of my house 2 months ago. A little company on DOE and they're called Good Solar, and they represent SunPower. Makes high-end PV arrays. A couple things I took away from the discussion. They're now mounting the inverter in the back of each array now, so it's not a separate device. And they're offering storage. And so the device is about 2.5 feet wide, it's about 5 feet tall, maybe 10 inches deep. It's part of the installation. And that will take advantage of this net metering problem in the time of use charging by Edison. So that's happening right now. Commercial product, I didn't get the price yet, but I'm still working with them on it. I don't know what
you have a problem, I got a good company.
So now, as far as that's just a personal thing. On the utility scale, that's a very important question. California is way out in front with huge installations now. I think it's between 8 and 10 gigawatts of PV arrays. We have, of course, a lot of wind as well. There is a intermittency with both wind and, of course, PV works really well during the middle of the day. And then as the sun sets and we go home and we turn on our lights, we have a mismatch of load and generation. It's referred to as the duck curve, for those of you that know of this. The Cal ISO, the independent system operator, not just in California, but elsewhere, they're trying to wrestle with this. So now the solution is clearly for the wind or solar power plant operators is to install a little storage to offset that excess generation in the day and just shift it. It's really a load shifting challenge. And those plants are being built now. Just saw one a month ago being announced. NextEra is out in front. NextEra Resources, they're building a plant in the Dakotas. They're bringing in lithium ion battery technology with PV and wind turbines, and they're matching them all together in an integrated system. I was personally involved in a project in 2012 in Hawaii where there was a 1 megawatt size battery bank that was installed with these wind turbines, and that was an experimental plant at the time. Funded partly by the Department of Energy. So that was now, 7, 8, 9 years ago. And so the industry is trying to wrestle with this. We're just now starting to build those plants. BP is also involved in this as well. And they're actively involved in putting storage in with these new plants. So it's happening right now.
Just a question. How many of you in the audience have taken a step towards either providing your own PV panels or driving Tesla or doing anything towards saving our resources? Well, that's great. At least half the room. Congratulations.
Question to Corey, but it's a little bit of a follow-up on Larry. You're hanging vertical solar panels, essentially. Are you focusing on new construction, or is there a payback for like tall buildings and reskinning? If you think of like Ventura Boulevard or down in LA, is that a feasibility for your product?
Yeah, definitely long term. Our first low-hanging fruit is new building, commercial construction. It's a pretty big piece of low fruit. I mean, there's more square meters of glass going up in new build construction than the entire solar market. So it's a huge market, and for us, it's the easiest. Or major retrofit. From there, we have a couple different ways to go. I mean, eventually, we can have a slightly different retrofit product. But the reality is a lot of even old buildings will retrofit with major retrofits because the payback is really good. And you know, as the regulations come across to older buildings, a lot of times it will just make sense to do a complete window change versus a reskinning, as you mentioned, or we have a potential film aftermarket film product. But that'll be a little bit down the line for us.
Well, again, when you remodel, the codes require you to meet certain energy thresholds, and most times when we do it, we have to replace windows on old buildings. So it's, you know, it's gonna happen.
It happens all the time. But even windows have they have a pretty short lifetime, actually. Wow, 30 years is the shortest. But they get their seals eventually crack and they get hazy inside and dew, and so they have to be replaced.
So for architects in the room who are doing ZNE buildings starting next year, couple of options I'm sure that we'll all want to know more about is there a way to incorporate any kind of wind energy into our projects? And also, are there other building materials that we should be looking to aside from windows? Are there wall systems that are in the works and other options like that?
I'll take the wind piece of that. Unfortunately, or fortunately, you look at it, the industry that's involved that I talked about that is delivering this cost-effective wind generator electricity is utility-scale wind turbines that are built in wind farms. There's been several attempts over the years to design roof structures or building-mounted wind turbines. They haven't been able to compete in terms of the electricity that you buy from the grid. That doesn't mean that we'll never get there. There are some options available. There's innovations that are being created all the time where someone has a new idea to integrate this thing into the building. But generally, they are not a cost-effective way compared to what you're buying your energy for from a utility. And that's just because of the scale, let's say, the size of these things. You probably saw how big our utility scale turbines are getting. You can't really mount those on a building. Develop a whole new building structure for that because of the loads that come into the structure. So right now there isn't what I would call really good cost-effective options for building mounted wind, not yet.
Yeah, there's a lot happening. I think it's going to be that's an area where you're going to see the biggest change occurring. Is in smart materials, it's living materials already making, like concrete that actually will grow. You know, it has a medium in it. There are a whole array of products that are out there in development. So I think you're going to see one of the things which I think is going to be going to actually happen, we're going to see it in our lifetime, is full-scale 3D printing and robotically built structures using computer technology and equipment that, comes out and, think of it as something on the back of a truck with an arm and a computer and a, drum of concrete, and they program it and it starts building a house. So we're going to see that.
Larry, I also noticed on some of your slides you talked about 20 DUs per acre. I think. What is that reference to?
That's the dwelling units per acre. It talks about density. So a lot of these things, you know, they only, when you talk about costs, they only become cost efficient when you reach a certain density of dwelling units per acre. Like, for example, you know, when you go to New York and you, you know, you look and here's a bagel store, and right next to it's another bagel store, and there's a storefront and then another bagel store, you go, how can it possibly be three bagel stores can it survive next to each other? Well, their average density in New York is 253 dwelling units per acre. And so there's a lot of demand. So single family is anywhere from 3 to 7 dwelling units per acre. That's why you don't see grocery stores in suburbs, because there's not enough density to support it. So you need a minimum of 20 units per acre to support neighborhood uses, public good like street lighting, good street trees, all these other things. Efficiency, all the energy efficiency comes when we have more density. So this won't happen in suburbia.
So and we're partnering with fabricators. They make insulated glass units. They sell to companies called Glazers. So Glazers are the companies that put aluminum frames around the window and install. So luckily, it's already been done, and we don't have a lot of innovation yet. So it's low current, which is even more important. It's going to be high voltage. For example, working with Walters and Wolf. Walters and Wolf is, I think, maybe the biggest glazing company on the West Coast. And they're extremely motivated about the technology because it allows them the opportunity to do this, install wires, and it brings new margins to them. Anything that's kind of new can create new margins for the field. And so they've already even completely designed a glazing product to try to keep more of the money for themselves versus the electrician. And so that would be the one component that the electrician has to come in. But currently, around the building, it's what we call a commercial building that we're moving on. And they're terrific. They're already getting UL certified to run the cables through. So they just run the cables through those. Again, they're already doing it. There are photovoltaic windows on the market with non-transparent solar cells. So it's also things called electrochromic windows, which are windows that tint automatically. So those you have to run wiring throughout the thing too. So they have experience with both of those. But they run it throughout that kind of framing system, which on a normal photovoltaic, you'll see it, a metal thing that the wires are on, see the wires just in conduit. That conduit cost is shockingly expensive. And so you're actually removing that, putting it in there. And the way they design their glazing, there's just kind of a little part that opens. So the electrician just needs to come in and snap the two wires together, close it. And it really acts, it's a window of doing that, it acts like any conventional solar cell on the market. And then so it runs to the base. Currently, right now, we're going to run it to the basement using string inverters. But yeah, I think there's plenty of room for innovation on that with microinverters and potentially eventually just kind of, I mean, we're already distributed the energy source compared to what's there, but even more just distributed throughout the building. There's no reason that can't happen. It's really 100% is the question of the cost of the microinverter, and there's lots of innovation happening.
I think the point was really well made that renewable energy generation is more cost efficient these days than hydrocarbon based. And I also really like the question about what we all can do personally to green our lives up and, you know, contribute to the green future that we'd all like to have. And I wanted to say that actually I just heard from SEE, our local provider, they have an option where you can elect to have green energy as your source instead of what the current supply is. And so that was something I felt I could do for myself, and we all do, I guess, if we wanted. So I elected for that, but I'll note it costs 15% more for renewable energy, which we mentioned is less, costs less to produce. So that was my question. Just wanted to see why you thought that was. You know, kind of goes back to the utility, SCE. Also note that, of course, the other big utility, the biggest, PG&E, is now bankrupt. So my question is, what role do these utilities play in the costs and in limiting our ability to make green choices?
Okay, well, I can start that. What happened several years ago now is the power plant ownership was taken away, essentially, from utilities. So Edison and PG&E don't own these power plants anymore. I'm not sure if you're aware of that. But they're owned by third parties, independent power producers primarily. And they then sell under contract to Edison or PG&E. They sell the power under a negotiated rate. Then Edison turns around and packages that as a product to us, and they're responsible now for essentially the distribution, the transmission and distribution of that power to our houses. And they charge whatever they need to charge to make money to, of course, maintain those lines. And that's why, for instance, PG&E is now in trouble, and Edison is subject to a lawsuit now as well about whether or not they're maintaining those lines properly when it's windy and there's fires. As far as though what they charge us and why is it now, why do they charge 15% more for green energy? I don't know. I have no idea. I think they're trying to capitalize on perhaps the perception of us wanting.
Same reason you pay more for organic food.
So at some point, the truth will be known that it's actually, at this point, is the organics actually in the long run will be cheaper because you don't have to pay for the pesticides. In the long run, the green energy will be cheaper because we won't have to mine on whether it be the coal, oil, gas, or whatever, and we don't have all the side effects of that. So I think it's probably an advantageous pricing opportunity for Edison, selling something which is attractive and making a margin. That would be my interpretation of that. I don't work for Edison, so I'm not sure. I know how businesses work.
And I don't know, I'm sure if they're doing this in there, but there's an issue with solar panels now, is their end of life. I mean, I think we're just coming to some of the early solar panels end of life, but what do you do with all the material that's in there? It's, you know, similar to the nuclear waste. I mean, there's a lot of chemicals and various metals in there that are dangerous and hazardous, and what do you do with these large solar panels as they come to the end of the life? And I'm not sure if they include that into their rates or not, but that's a story to keep in mind.
First of all, wonderful information, really interesting. I'm curious what your feeling is about how to accelerate the transition from a hydrocarbon world to the kinds of things that you guys are talking about. When you add up Shell and Exxon, you know, all of the large industries that are hydrocarbon industries, it dwarfs the alternative energy world. And there's some stress out there about whether we can get there in time. And I'm just curious, you know, this is a sort of a macro kind of question, but I'm curious your feelings about it.
I mean, I think it's a big cruise liner that you're trying to turn around. You know, it doesn't just turn like a speedboat. You know, like, again, going back to 2000 when we did Colorado Court, you know, no one was really even doing solar panels. We were told, like, we'd have the building inspector come out and look at our solar system, and he'd go, well, if Edison signs off on it, we'll sign off on it. And Edison would come look at it and go, well, if the building department signs off on it, we'll sign off. No one knew what even to do. We couldn't even get engineers, you know, to do it. I had a friend of mine who was a physicist designing the whole building. Now every engineer does it. So the kind of momentum is there. I think it's, you know, as, like, you know, I just, it's interesting when I see you guys present, because you've been, you know, it's taken you
30 years to become an overnight success. You know, and you're kind of in the infancy of that, right? And so it just takes time, but we're fortunate that we're in a place which is not only, you know, willing, but we embrace it, we want it. You know, so we've historically been leaders in that area. So I'm glad when you think of the way you do, we need to accelerate it more. But if there's any place that's working hard, it's in this state.
I feel your stress, but I'm really optimistic. Just look what happened. This is already happening with solar. It's the majority of new energy in the last couple of years is solar. I think you, Doug, showed a graph showing solar and wind being 30% of the energy by 2050. I mean, I show you another report that shows it being 50% by 2035, which is 15 years away. And again, solar's come down order of magnitude in the last few years, and it's going everywhere. Just, you know, the taking our technology out on the road. Just a change of the regulations in Europe and saying, hey, we've got to do this. And, you know, the stress people are having about solving that, I mean, you can feel it. You can feel it everywhere that we go to and show our product to. There's a lot of excitement about doing something about that. And the European code about net zero buildings, again, buildings consume 40% of the world's energy. It's a huge part of the problem. To make all new buildings be net zero in a year from now. That's pretty impressively aggressive to me.
And I think, you know, our government's getting more involved. California is doing a lot, you know, certainly about, you know, certainly the nation can do more. There's a lot of countries in the world. Sweden has sort of set out the goal to try to become energy neutral by the year, I think, 2030. They want to have the whole country neutral. The United States, 2% of the new cars sold in the last 5 years have been electric. In Norway, it's been 48%. So they're offering incentives to do it. There's, I mean, it's obviously a lot smaller population, but the governments, it seems to be in Scandinavia, Sweden and Norway and places, seem to be offering a lot of incentives through the governments to make alternate energy much more of a useful everyday thing. And I think our government needs to get on that bandwagon and stop subsidizing oil companies. There's still a lot of subsidies to go on, and turn those subsidies into alternate energy, you know, credits or whatever. What if they got it, you should do?
Just my thought on that. Hold on, Michael, 1 second. I just had a thought. It comes down to governments and policy, and if we feel that we're not getting the right policy out of our government, we need to change who's in the government. That's how you accelerate that. The second one is corporations. Corporations drive a lot of behavior. And if we feel that corporate behavior is not in line with our ideals, we should not support that corporation. That's how you change that. And I showed you a list of 100 companies that have signed up to be renewable 100%. Okay, so those are the leaders in this area. And they're not small companies. And then the last is ourselves. And so, you know, our family, our community, our neighbors, friends, we need to walk the walk. And so we in the end drive it all by our behavior towards observing what our government's doing or our corporations are doing. But in the end it's about us. So we accelerate it by joining hands and, you know, surrounding ourselves with like-minded people and making a difference.
Quick question on net positive buildings, because the nexus with the architecture and insulation and then the window systems and even all the alternative energy systems, when buildings produce more than they consume, then all of a sudden driving your Tesla home and plugging it in and letting your house charge your car and you're paying zero for fuel. Where do you see that happening? And I know that's already on the landscape. Maybe Larry and Corey, you guys can talk a little bit about that.
Well, you can do that now by, you know, like I have a Tesla and I have solar on my house. I have solar on my office. And I size the system so that I can plug my car in at home or work for free. You know, so I don't, not only do I not go to a gas station, I drive around for free. You know, so you can do it just by, you know, net positive. But, you know, again, it's a very sophisticated, these guys can stupid. And so, you know, we can make it that way, but they also, you know, there's energy policy has rarely changed since the time when we were building infrastructure. And there's a lot of profit being made. So when you make a lot of profit, you try to protect those profits.
Okay, I think we have time for one or two more questions. Bob?
What do you think it's going to look like 30 years from now? You think so? Yeah. 30 years from now?
Well, what it's going to look like, the state or the world? Or?
Well, the, I guess if you will, the production of carbon, the reduction of carbon, the whole question of really climate change, that's for the next 30 years.
You might be able to put your beach chair right out there and sit on the ocean. That's what it might look like.
So that's okay.
Well, you know, part of my perspective, as I mentioned earlier, we're not out of oil yet. And we need 70% of our oil goes to transportation. And until we can find a way to improve that transportation and get things from A to B a lot cheaper and more efficiently, we're going to be needing oil for a long time. And I mean, a lot of the other resources we talked about here, really for generating electricity, you know, too. But there's also heating is involved, you know, natural gas, oil for the cars. So there's a lot of aspects that need to go into considering how we minimize our use of oil. And again, we need to start now, and these guys are leading the way in the electricity side of it. I think we need to find the same technology uses in how we make more efficient use of oil.
What I usually do is I just
I think ultimately, ceiling, I mean, I think we have our
so it's
thinking
just weird
is always we look
I get
for
you
solutions
that you want more light
to things which are great, but at some point we also have to modify our behavior, you know, and so
I know.
That's
so it's
really
just tough
kind
because
of how I think it's going to we run into this all the time, you know, like I did a $3 million house I designed, no air conditioning in it at all, and then I did a subsidized by the city of LA affordable housing project about 20 blocks away. They forced us to spend $400,000 to air condition
them.
It makes
really
no sense,
anyway.
You know, and so like I think we just got to have sensible behavior and not be sued for every single, you know, thing that we do.
And I'm sure all you Santa Barbara architects would agree that we have sensible regulations here in Santa Barbara.
I'd like to add to the 30-year, it's called vision, because there's something which maybe you're aware of, maybe you're not, but approximately 40 states in the United States have already implemented what's called a renewable portfolio standard, and that obligates utilities, power producers in their state, to have a certain percentage of their mix coming from renewables by a certain date. So that's already locked and loaded. That's happening. California is one of the leaders in that area. Also, just this week, I saw the fifth state has now signed up and committed to 100% of their power from renewable by 2050. It's the fifth state to do that now in the U.S. alone. There's other countries that are making that goal, but this is now local in the U.S. So those two things combined. Also, we have now a Department of Energy goal to have 20% of our energy or power, in this case, generated by wind by 2030. And California has a similar type of goal with wind and solar. So those things are already in place and they're rolling. And so what will it look like? I expect us to achieve those goals or come close to it. And what will drive it is, you know, the large users of electricity. And when I talk about Google as an example, or even Microsoft, these are huge users, global users of electricity. All our cloud-based storage of photographs and data now, these data centers use an unbelievable amount of electricity. And so when they sign up and commit, and last year Google achieved it, if you look at all of their facilities all the way around the world, they are basically carbon net zero. And they made a commitment because the wind doesn't always blow, the sun doesn't always shine, so at some point in time they have to use power from the grid. They went ahead and measured what that was, and they bought additional wind and solar to compensate for that. And that's how they went to a zero carbon footprint. So with corporate leadership like that, and that spread around the world, I feel quite bullish 30 years from now, we'll be in a much better position than we're now.
Well, that is some great news for us to end on, and I'd like to thank our panelists. Thank you so much for coming on. I remind you all that third Wednesday of next month, we'll have our EdTech panel here, and if you have questions, I'm sure our panelists will stick around. So come back next month for Education Technology, and thank you again.